Hello everyone, I am the Double Agent, and so far, 2015 has actually been a pretty great year for music. By mid-spring, I had already filled out my 2015 best list twice over. The charts were just blooming with great hits from old returning acts as well as some fresh new ones. Things were looking great, what the fuck happened? This top 20 is a disaster. It's like all the really shitty, low-hanging spring hits decided to peak all at once. Out of the 15 new songs on this list, I can honestly say that I genuinely enjoy and would actively seek out about 3 of them. That is a 1-5 ratio, 20-10 levels of pathetic. I am really not looking forward to this. And on that note, let's get started. This is my fight song. Take back my life song. I know this pick is probably going to cause some controversy, and I want you guys to understand. I didn't put this song at the bottom because it's necessarily the most annoying song in the top 20, or even the least interesting. I'm putting this song here because it is the closest any song has come in the past year to not being a song. There's absolutely no reason to listen to this. The beat is jacked straight from 5 other self-empowerment anthems, and there is next to no personality to Rachel's vocals. She is lukewarm water personified. Her voice is way too smooth to have any real kick to it, but it's not nearly smooth enough to be pleasant. Then again, even if the vocals were amazing, even if Jesus Christ himself rose from the ground to perform this, it would still be shit. It's just so non-specific. Generic lyrics, generic chord progression, generic melody, I swear, I've heard this all before. It feels like it only exists to be in movie trailers, and it's not even powerful enough to do that. It's not even catchy enough to be a commercial jingle, it's just nothing. 3.5 minutes of absolutely nothing. This is what people who hate Kelly Clarkson must hear in every Kelly Clarkson song. And speaking of artists who have been releasing the same song for 3 years in a row, DJ Mustard. Put that on that beat, yo. If y'all chick come close to me, she ain't going home where she supposed to be. Well, looks like our plans to isolate the mustard plague have failed. A vaccine's in the works, but it won't be ready until about 2017. I predict about 12 more waves and millions of casualties. This song really isn't that bad at first glance, especially by Mustard standards. The production is actually pretty complex this time around. But then, as you keep listening, you realize that, in the wrong hands, complexity is not a good thing. I honestly never thought I'd say this, but maybe DJ Mustard should just stick to minimalist shit. I mean, it's cool to see him step out of his comfort zone, but like, don't make me listen to it or anything. None of the song's many elements are really all that good on their own. They're all very incoherent and melodically directionless as standalone loops. And even within the song, they never really connect with each other beyond coexisting. They don't mesh, they just kind of pile up on top of each other. I can never enjoy the song as a whole, I'm always forced to listen to one individual element, constantly being reminded of how terrible it sounds on top of the others. It's absolutely miserable, damn near torturous. This song is a horrible mess, it really is, but then again, what was I supposed to expect from DJ Mustard, Chris Brown, Chris DeRulo, and Japanese text-to-speech machine number 45897? What is this even doing here? Why is this in the top 20, let alone the top 3 for fuck's sake? Okay, like, I'm not gonna sit here and try to argue that this is the worst song ever or anything. I know that there's a time and place for songs like this. Obviously, this isn't something you're just supposed to listen to casually in your car or on the radio or something. It's a dance song, it's for the clubs. So that's how I'm gonna judge it. I'm not gonna berate it for its simple as shit lyrical content because really that's all they need it to be. They're telling you what dance moves to do. That's their only purpose and they execute it well. But goddamn, that beat. What is this grating shit? Where's the power? Where's the drop? The last time I heard bass this week was on a Kidz Bop album. This honestly sounds like a rejected Soulja Boy beat. Which is fitting because they actually stole some of his dance moves too. Also, is it just me or does Silento sound exactly like Sway from Ray Shreppard? Actually, now that I think about it, the beat to this actually sounds a lot like the beat to No Flex Zone. I could go on for hours describing this song's every individual flaw, like how banal the lyrics are, how awkward the mixing is, Kidding's complete non-presence, the egregious vocal effects, how irritatingly sharp and processed everything sounds, and how it blatantly ripped off the Talk Dirty formula, arguably worse than GDFR. But what bugs me the most about this song is the fact that it exists. Why did someone decide to make this? Who made this? Who is this for? What is this for? Why is this for? How is this for? Why is this? Who is this? Where is this? When is this? How is this? I am the Double Agent, asking the important questions. So no, honey, I'm good. I can have another, but I probably should not. To me, Andy Grammer has always been the poor man's Michael Bublé, and it's kind of a shame to see the ripoff outchart the original, and the song being complete shit is definitely not helping matters. Something about this melody just irks me. The instrumental is way too bouncy, to the point where I can't even really tell what instruments they're using. There's a serious gap in tone between the beat and the lyrics. The mood is just so bubbly and upbeat that it almost makes you forget that you're listening to a song about a man who ended up one drink away from cheating on his girlfriend, describing the ordeal in detail. And the song plays it off like his common sense to back away is some sort of grand romantic gesture. Like, oh, honey, I almost cheated on you. It was so close, so tempting. I was gonna do it, but I didn't. Isn't that adorable? Look at how thoughtful I am for not cheating on someone. Ugh. Cause baby, now we got— oh god, this song. Taylor Swift trying to be genuinely edgy. Lord help us all. This is just garbage. Even the good parts of this song kind of suck. Kendrick Lamar is pretty poorly used here. His flow is stilted by this awkward, forced rhythm that just keeps changing throughout both verses without ever getting better. It's always slightly off-tempo. Still though, it's better than Taylor's contributions. Seriously, hearing Taylor Swift scream her way through this awkwardly phrased chorus on top of this dark, clunky beat is one of the most insufferable things I can imagine doing right now. It's just those strained enunciations on the very wrong part of each line. That garbage disposal chord progression leading up to a drop in the middle of the goddamn chorus. Everything about this is so loud, but not in the powerful way, just in the annoying way. You can't even just turn the volume down either, because then everything just turns to fuzz. Just fuck this song. I never thought I'd miss Shake It Off. This song irritates me especially because I didn't want to hate this. The production is actually pretty great, especially considering Guetta's past work, but shit, those lyrics just kill it, and not in the good way. I never expected a woman to present herself as so willingly submissive in such a powerful anthemic track, especially not Nicki Minaj, whose entire character is built upon her sexual freedom. It's really off-putting. The music video reminds me a lot of Mad Max, which is fitting. Because if a woman grew up in the Mad Max universe, under the captivity of men, taught from day one that she was an object who existed just to please men, this is probably what she'd say. I'll provide that, you will always have it. I'll be on deck, keep it in check. When you need that, I'ma let you have it. I'd say more, but a couple of my colleagues have already made a review of the song, and they've said pretty much all there is to say, so links in the description. Bitch better have my money. Y'all should know me well. Over the past few years, it seems kinda like Rihanna's only real method to remain relevant is to conform to trends. In 2012, she started making EDM, in 2013, she made a strip club anthem, and in 2014, she took a break because nothing happened that year. So I guess it's only fitting that in 2015, she released a full-on trap song. And how is it? Eh. The production here is kinda off. Even for a trap song, it's pretty poorly maintained and oddly sporadic. Each element follows a seemingly completely randomized melody. The hi-hat is completely out of control here. Kinda sounds like a frog. And that echo effect that stretches out across the entire song, while it is good at setting a tone, it can be pretty distracting at times. But overall, my problem with this song isn't the production, but how poorly Rihanna's able to work with it. She does not have the right voice for this kind of song, and in no way does she try to control it. It's very shrill and overpowering with all those random cracks. It stands out way too much against this dark, gritty backdrop. She's scraping the edge of the wrong half of her range. It gives off a very unpleasant, creepy, threatening vibe, and not in the way it intended. When the vocals to a trap song work better over the beat to Loyal than they do on the actual song, you have a problem. Meh. I don't like this song at all, but it really isn't as bad as people are making it out to be. I definitely expected much worse from a Justin Bieber Skrillex collab, I'll say that much. Also, is it just me, or is this drop, like, really weak? Come on, this sounds like a goddamn slide whistle. Try again. Wait a minute. Hold up. Play that again. Fuck, fuck. The voices! The voices are back! Cause I just wanna look good for you, good for you. And here we have Selena Gomez, Gomezing things up a bit. Oh, what do you have for us this time? A somber love ballad? Huh, never would have guessed. It's not bad, but I've already heard Begging for Thread, and once you've had the 5-star wild salmon, everything else just kinda tastes like cat food. Next! I honestly never thought I'd say these words more than once. This Jason Derulo song is completely tolerable. Not good, not bad, right in the middle. A little melodically annoying, a little lyrically confusing, but not enough to bother me. Congrats, Derulo. You've been temporarily removed from my shit list. Your ribbon's in the mail. Girl, you're perfect. You're always worth it. Remember how this was pretty much at the bottom of my last ranking? Yeah, I guess you could say I've warmed up to this song, but it's really more accurate to say that I've stopped caring about it. Back in spring, the general tone of everything was much brighter, and this song really stuck out as particularly dull and grating. Now it's just kind of started to blend in. Still, it's easily my least favorite Weeknd song on the charts right now. This song is cute, I'll give it that. And it definitely has a relaxing, summery vibe to it. But it does kind of bug me that the only thing Omi seems to value in this girl is that she stays quiet and supports him unconditionally. The power dynamics just feel unbalanced is all. Also, I know this is controversial for some reason, but I honestly prefer the original over the remix. Mostly because the original is actually on key.
Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
Don't get me wrong, I like this. It's well produced, it's well written, it's well performed, it's emotionally driven, everything works well, nothing feels out of place. And it's a great tribute to Paul Walker, albeit an unintentional one. In pretty much every way, this song is great. But I never want to hear it again. Don't get me wrong, I like this. It's well produced, it's well written, it's well performed, it's incredibly catchy and upbeat, it's packed to the brim with personality, and it's very fun. In pretty much every way, this song is great. But I never want to hear it again. Don't get me wrong, I like this. It's well produced, it's well written, it's well performed, it's full of personality, it's a wonderful burst of energy, and I'm so glad it turned out to be as successful as it was. In pretty much every way, this song is great. But I never want to hear it again. Yeah, after about 7 months, I think it's safe to say I am finally sick of these three songs. Uptown Funk in particular. The other two have a chance, but don't expect this one to show up on the best of 2015 list. Yeah, mostly because it already topped the 2014 list, but still.
I can feel my face when I'm with you.
Honestly, I really didn't like The Weeknd that much when he debuted. He just seemed kind of boring to me. But as he kept releasing more and more interesting singles as time went on, I began to realize that he has some serious potential as a performer. Enter Can't Feel My Face, Stage Left. A lot of people claim this sounds like a Michael Jackson song. And honestly, I don't hear it. I mean, maybe the harmonization on the chorus and the bass line, sure. And The Weeknd's voice is weirdly pitched up here, he doesn't really sound like himself. But otherwise, it's kind of lost on me. Then again, I haven't really listened to that much MJ, so I don't know. At most, I'd consider this a heavily modernized throwback, and a good one at that. It has a really smooth 80s kind of feel to it, but it's still original enough to keep its own identity. And it's also incredibly catchy, which is a plus. This song fascinates me. Everything about it is genuinely quantifiably horrible. But I love it. Laser and Snake's production clash pretty severely. The club and trap elements are constantly competing to be the loudest, and it's especially apparent on the chorus. But in a weird way, it actually kind of works. Most vocals are incredibly grating, and they stick out completely from the instrumentation. And yet, they're ultimately the glue that holds all the unrelated elements together. The lyrics are useless, nonsensical, and meaningless. And yet, they tell a fascinating story about a loss of innocence. The drop is terrible. It's incredibly irritating, worse than Where Are You Now's even. And yet, it creates such a great atmosphere.
I honestly don't know why anyone likes this, but I know I do.
Yep, from second to last all the way up to second in the span of 3 months. You could say I pulled a complete 180 here. In fact, assuming that a shift from first to last is equal to 180, let's see, divide that into 19 sections, one individual shift has the approximate value, and you're gone. Look, guys, shut up, it grew on me, okay? I mean, listen to it. The beat, that voice, those lyrics, it's just so adorable. The production is both incredibly catchy and pretty well layered. Betty's vocals hit that perfect spot between gritty and squeaky that just works wonders. And it's great to see a rap singer portray genuine affection for what is probably a person. Oddly refreshing in a way. Sure, it's kind of vague and mildly confusing, but hey, if this is the best bright, catchy shit we're gonna get, I'll take it. The Weeknd has really grown on me in the past couple months, and you have this song to thank for that. I never really hated The Weeknd, it's just that a lot of his songs kind of struck me as soft back in spring. But this is the kind of fucked up shit that The Weeknd is meant to work with. It's honest, it's interesting, and most of all, it's powerful as fuck. The somber, chilling verses, that scream right before the chorus, the overpowering, speaker-shattering bass, and that total atmospheric collapse in the bridge only to build back up to the chorus again. It's dark, ugly, disturbing, vile, gritty, and horrendous in all the right ways. But most of all, I picked the song as my top choice because I think it's a perfect representation of what happened to music in the past couple months. It's not even that music got worse, per se. The ratio of good to bad music actually stayed relatively consistent if you don't count overplays a factor. It's more of a sudden shift in tone. Almost out of nowhere, the bad music just got dull. And the good music just got way darker. all while the massive, brighter, catchier smash hits got overplayed to shit. It's just constant, unchanging gray with no color to break up the monotony besides the occasional ugly-ass bright orange. It just doesn't feel like summer, you know? I really hope this is just a rough patch that we're eventually gonna get through, sooner rather than later, because I really want the summer to end on a good note. And until then, I'm the Double Agent, and I promise you that 1985 video's coming next. See you in a couple weeks.